In 1970, Paul Murdin is a young English astronomer trying to secure his next job.
I was a research fellow. I was coming to the end of my three-year contract, and I thought, what can I contribute to finding out what these things are?
Using the largest telescope in England, he begins searching the area of the constellation Cygnus, the Swan. He decides to hunt for pairs of stars. Pairs of stars are called binaries. Many of the stars we see, perhaps half, are actually binaries, pairs of orbiting stars locked together by gravity. But Murdin wonders, is it possible there are binaries where only one of the stars is visible?
I thought that maybe there was a kind of a star system in which there was a star, one ordinary star that made light, and then there was another star nearby that made X-rays.
The telltale sign of a binary is that the stars are moving around each other. So Murdin begins searching for a visible star that shows signs of motion.
Sometimes it's coming towards you, sometimes it's coming away. Sometimes it's coming towards you, sometimes it's coming away.
When the star is moving toward us, it appears more blue as the wavelength of its light gets shorter. Moving away, it appears more red as the wavelength of its light gets longer. This is known as Doppler shift. After looking for color changes in hundreds of stars in the area of Cygnus, Murdin spots a possible suspect, a visible star whose light is shifting as though moving around.
It very clearly was a binary star, a double star. The star was moving around and around with a period going round once every 5.6 days.
But whatever it's going around can't be seen.
There was no trace in the spectrum of the second star. There was one star there, there wasn't the second star there.
Murdin has a binary pair in which only one star is visible. The second object emits X-rays, has enough mass and gravity to dramatically move a star, but gives off no light. Could it be the corpse of a star massive enough to become a black hole?
The crucial issue in deciding whether Cygnus X1 was a black hole was to measure the mass of the X-ray emitting object.
It would have to be very massive, at least three times the mass of our sun. If not, it's probably just a neutron star. A collapsed star that's dense, but not heavy enough to be a black hole. From his observations, Murdin is able to make an estimate of the mass of the invisible partner.
And the answer came out to be 6 times the mass of the sun. So there was a story then that Cygnus X1 was a black hole. And the key to the argument was that the mass of the star you couldn't see was more than 3 solar masses. When I'd finished writing it all out, I sat back and thought, it's a black hole.